أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما بعد, we begin by saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from shaitan and cursed. For he is, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, he is Adubu Mubin. He is the clear and avowed enemy of mankind. There is no enemy like the enemy of shaitan. If you don't understand the reality of shaitan, then you will lose. If you don't understand the reality of shaitan's relentlessness, that he's relentless, that shaitan don't care about your feelings, shaitan don't care about your tears, he doesn't care about your emotions, right? He doesn't care about your family. He is a Dhumma Mubin, okay? And those that follow him, they are the Shayateen, whether they're from mankind or jinn, okay? You must understand that Shaitan, again, this is just a dhikr. We're speaking, but as we go through, inshallah, just reminders, because reminder benefits the believer. We must understand that Shaitan, that he has the Shayateen, those that follow Shaitan from mankind and the jinn. And the jinn are the unseen spirits, the unseen forces. Right, they come from the word ishtinan, which means that which is unseen, or the eye cannot see. So we must understand that shaitan is a jinn. He's not an angel. He's a jinn. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Kahf, that it was shaitan and he was a jinn. He was the one that was mustaqbalin. He was of those who were arrogant towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the first person to disobey Allah's commandments. He went from Azazil, which is the name of Shaitan, before he became Iblis, or before he became Shaitan, his name was Azazil. Okay, this is in the top seal of Ibn Kathir. So the name of Shaitan was Azazil before he became Shaitan or Iblis. And Iblis means one who was void of any mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Shaitan, he has no get back. He has no repentance. He cannot be forgiven from Allah. He has no mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of Iblis. The one who was born of any mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what Iblis means. Okay? So before he became Iblis, or before he became Shaitan, he was Azazil. And he was a jinn. And before mankind was created, there was jinn. And he was the most obedient of the jinns. He had a crown. And he was the Khalifa of the earth before Adam alayhi salam was created. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told not only the angels, but Shaitan, or Iblis, or Azazil, because he was so pious at that time that he was able to fly with the angels, or be with the angels, but he was not an angel, but he was able to be with the angels. And so Allah SWT said that he's going to create his best creation, which was Adam alayhi salam. And so Allah SWT said that he told everybody to bow down, and said they all bow down, illa Iblis. Everybody bowed down except Iblis. Now some people might read this ayat and say that he told all the angels to bow down, and said they all bow down except Iblis. Okay? But if you go to another ayat in chapter 18, verse 50, it said Iblis, and he was a jinn. So we have to use the Quran to explain the Quran. We can't just say because we heard as Christians, or the Christians believe that the devil was an angel, that we believe that he was an angel. He was not an angel. The angels, they do not disobey the commandments of Allah. The angels, they do not have the ability to disobey the commandment of Allah. They weren't created for that. Right? They were created only to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the jinn, and there's a whole chapter in the Quran, chapter 72, called jinn. Okay, so this is real. Okay? So, but the jinn, Shaitan, he was a jinn. So he has the ability, and the jinns have the ability to obey or disobey. Just like mankind, we have the ability to obey Allah, or we have the ability to disobey Allah. Same thing with the jinns. They have the ability to obey, disobey. So Shaitan, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he's going to create Adam alayhi salam to be his best creation, he said he all bowed down except Iblis, and he was a jinn. Okay? So when he disobeyed Allah's commandment, we're told in the tafsir in the hadith that when he disobeyed Allah's commandment, he changed from Azazil, which was one who was beautiful or handsome or jameel, and he was changed to Shaitan. And it said that when he changed to Shaitan, it was like there was a sound of a bell. Ding! And he changed from Azazil to Shaitan or Iblis. We're told in Hadith, even the bell, we're supposed to be careful with the bells or certain instruments because they call it the jinn. It says that when Shaitan was changed from Azazil to Iblis, it was like from the sound of a bell. Ding! And he changed from Azazil to Iblis. So, Iblis, or Shaitan, because he was of those who are Tawbah, or those who are transgressed the vows, he told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he knew he was going to the hellfire. He knew that he was going to the hellfire, so he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for time. He said, wait a second, before you send me to the hellfire, give me a little bit of time to prove to you that this creation, this black clay, this mud, is not worthy of being your best creation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him time. He said, you have until the day they are raised up. Right? So Shaitan said, bet, because you have made me Tawbah, right? And you made me of those who are Rajim, right? I will come to them from the right, the left, the front, and the back, and you will not find most of them of the Shakirin. You will not find most of them who are thankful, and most of them will disobey you. So Allah said, bet, those who follow my Huda, those who follow my guidance when it comes to them, you will have no sultan, you will have no control over them. But those that follow you, meaning Shaitan, they'll be with you in the fire. Okay? So Shaitan, from the time that Adam was created, he waged war against all of us. Shaitan don't care, he waged war against Adam. Right? Because he was jealous of Adam. Shaitan was made out of red smokeless fire. Right? Adam alayhi salam was made out of a clay, of a black clay. So he thought because he was red or ran out of fire, he could burn, that he looked at the insignificance of this clay or this mud. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew better. Okay? So this is Shaitan, a dual woman being, just a little dhikr. Okay? So we see the rest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Shaitan and curse. We begin in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Truly and verily, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise him and seek on his help his forgiveness. We also see the rest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Sayyati Amayna, which are those actions and deeds that are not sanctioned by Allah, the Quran, and the Sunnah. So we see the rest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from doing actions or deeds that he does not want us to do. Those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills to be guided to Islam. And what is Islam? Islam is our religion. Islam is the name of our deen. Islam means submission to the will and commandment of Allah. Those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills to be guided to Islam, no one can lead them astray. And those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills to be led astray, right, meaning off the Surat al-Mustaqim, off Islam, off their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one will guide them. We bear witness that there's no God but Allah, the one God who has no partners, and we bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is his name, his messenger, amma ba'd. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the best speech is the speech of Allah, the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of all matters are those things that are innovated by the people pertaining to this religion. We do not innovate, we do not delete or add to this religion. Whatever was done in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's what we do today. The verse or the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in this day I have perfected your religion for you. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that ayat, this is in chapter 5, verse 3. Okay, chapter 5, verse 3, Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in this day I have perfected for you and completed for you your religion, your deen, and chosen for you Islam as your deen. We're told in the tafsir, the explanation of the Quran, that this ayat was revealed 8 days before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died. So 8 days before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, this ayat, this verse was revealed saying that this day I have completed your religion. Meaning, whatever was done at that time, 8 days before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, that was the deen. We don't have to add to it, we don't have to delete it, none of that. That was the deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he made this deen complete. Okay, so this deen is complete. We don't have to add to it, we don't have to delete nothing to it, we don't have to try to make it better, right? We don't have to try to figure things out. It's already been figured out for us. We're Muslims. The best thing for the Muslim to do is to submit. Okay? So therefore, the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of all matters are those things that are innovated by the people. For all innovation leads to bid'ah, all bid'ah leads to dalala, all dalala is in the nar. So we see pressure in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that nar. Alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin. Inshallah, just a short talk from today's khutbah, just, you know, piggybacking and continuing from today's khutbah. And the subject matter was on Muslim identity, We talked about that first, and then now Muslim unity. With regards to the Muslim identity, right, we talked about, first and foremost, that you have to believe and understand that your religion, which is Islam, is the best thing going. Ain't nothing better than this deen. Ain't nothing better than the Quran. Ain't nothing better than the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you believe that anything is better than this deen, anything is better than the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are sadly mistaken. Not only that, if you think that there's any system or any type of format, blueprint, whatever it may be, is better than the Quran and the Sunnah, man, you will be tiptoeing on the God as a kufr, which is disbelief. Okay? Because this is a concept of Tawheed. This is a concept of Tawheed. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in Hadith, you do not have Iman, you do not believe, unless your natural inclination and your natural instinct is my Sunnah. What does that mean? You do not believe unless your natural instinct, your natural inclination, right, you ain't got to think about it, is my Sunnah. Meaning that a real Muslim, one who really believes, man, he walks, talks, sleeps, even creeps like a Muslim. Everything that he does is like a Muslim. Go to the bathroom, like a Muslim. Conduct himself, like a Muslim. His adab, his akhlaq, is like a Muslim. His mannerism is like a Muslim. How he dresses is like a Muslim. Why? Because if you believe your natural inclination, your natural instinct is Islam. You speak like a Muslim. You walk like a Muslim. You talk like a Muslim. That's Iman. If we're striving to do anything other than be a Muslim, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those whom you love, that's who you be raised with. So now you better look deep into yourself and ask yourself, who do I love? Who do I like listening to? What do I like doing? How do I like dressing? How do I like talking? What type of stuff do I like watching on TV? Okay? If you say everything other than Abu Bakr or Prophet Muhammad or, you know, any type of, if you say anything other than that, then guess what, man, we've been led astray. Okay? We must understand that in this society, which is America, or it's California, we even say San Bernardino, living in a society that is not an Islamic society, pay attention. Being in a society that is not an Islamic society, somehow, some way, you have been conditioned and touched or affected or contaminated by the society. Whether you know it or not, whether you want to or not. They say that one bad apple spoils the bunch, right? So what about millions of bad apples? The Muslims are not the majority out here, the Muslims are the minority out here. So if you're surrounded and engulfed by non-Muslims, then somehow, some way, your norms become not that of a Muslim. So what do we do with that? Or what happens with that? First and foremost, we lose our Muslim identity. Right? We lose our Muslim identity. We're not supposed to strive to look like the non-Muslims. We should be striving to look like the Muslims. What does a Muslim look like? We got to know the hadiths now. What does a Muslim wear? What does a Muslim don't wear? How does he wear his hair? How does he do this? All these things we must try to understand. Especially when we're living in a non-Islamic society. Especially when living in a non-Islamic society. We have an amanah, we have a trust, right? We have something that we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in living in a non-Islamic society. I'm going to share a hadith with you. And please pay attention to this hadith. It's a hadith that, inshallah, it's a scary hadith, but at the same time, it's a hadith that will make us reflect. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, the angels of destruction, meaning they're going to destroy a town, they were coming to a town, and as they were getting ready to destroy this town, the angels saw that there were Muslims in this town. So the angels can say, Ya Allah, but there's Muslims in this town. So Allah, even though he knows all things, he does know all things, he said, I know that there's Muslims in this town, but destroy them first. Destroy the Muslims first. Because they live with the people. They intertwine with the people. They see the ill norms and dysfunctions of the people. But instead of enjoying the right and forbidding the wrong, They just lived with the people and didn't do anything. Matter of fact, they enjoyed being in the company of these people. So destroy them first. So let's look at this hadith. So the angels of destruction were coming to this town. Like we talk about Ad or Thamud or whatever type of people. The people of Saleh, Su'aib, whatever. The angels were coming to destroy this town, flip it upside down, fire, brimstone, whatever, tornado, whatever it's going to be. But inside that town, let's look at the people of Lot. You know the people of Lot, the homosexuals, the faggots and whatnot. Y'all say faggot. Homosexuals, faggots, the people of Lot. Okay? Allah took the whole city, flipped it upside down. And one of the prophet's wives, because she looked back, she got burned for looking back. Okay? But the reality of the matter is, God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, took this city and destroyed it because of their homosexuality. Now, if Allah destroyed the whole city because they was practicing homosexuality and they didn't want to stop homosexuality, man, that sounds kind of like where we at right here. They got a whole bunch of homosexuality going on and they don't want to stop the homosexuality. Matter of fact, you got preachers and whatnot saying it's okay to be gay. It's okay to be gay. Okay? So, looking at history, looking at scripture, and looking at the stories of old, Allah SWT said he will flip-flop, boom, and destroy certain cities and certain nations because of certain sins or certain actions. That's scary. Okay? We live in this homosexual society, lesbian, LBG, whatever they call that. So, should we not be fearful or thinking that Allah SWT will destroy this sub-society because of all the things that's going on? And then we don't want to be involved in that taxing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of these things that are going on. Then surely instead of being with these people and loving and hugging and squeezing and teasing these people, we should strive to be of those who show the opposite. We should be of those who enjoy the right and forbid the wrong. No, there's no compulsion of religion. But at the same time, as Muslims, we will be firm and standing strong in what it is that we believe in. We will not falter, we will not compromise. The best da'wah is by example. The best way you call people to this deen is by example. It ain't talking about it, it's being about it. It ain't talking about it, it's being about it. We can talk all day. A parrot can repeat the same thing you're talking about. You can train a parrot. That's a parrot, right? A bird. But does that bird, can it do what it's talking about? It just talks to it. It's like that. Right? But the bird, it can't do no actions. So let's not be birds around here. Let's not be copycatters. The best da'wah is by learning the knowledge and applying the knowledge. Okay? Again, like I said, the subject today at the Jumma was Muslim identity and Muslim unity. You know, the Muslim identity, first and foremost, man, we have to be proud, you know what I'm saying, to be Muslim. I'm proud to be Muslim because before I was Muslim, I wasn't Muslim. I was a Catholic. Non-believer. The Prophet Muhammad said that you do not believe unless you hate going back to Kufr. Right? After you've been blessed with Islam. You hate to go back to Kufr the same way you would be hate to be thrown into the hellfire. So some of us that didn't have Islam, but now we have Islam, man, we're supposed to hate going backwards. We're supposed to hate that. Man, I don't want to go back to that. I don't want to go back to the chitlins. And I don't want to go back to that. Huh? So now we have Islam, we should be those who are thankful. Right? We should be those who are appreciative. Because there's a lot of people out here, again speaking about the Muslim identity, there's a lot of people out here that are walking, they're walking dead. There's a lot of people out here, they're walking dead. They're dead. They're walking dead. They don't even know why they're here. They don't know about heaven and hell. They don't even know about Allah. They don't know about the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They don't even know about the Quran. They're just walking dead. Just eating, sleeping, and looking and pissing. Don't even know they're headed to the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, because we've been blessed with Islam, right? We've been blessed with Islam. Allah SWT said in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. All you believe, save yourself and your family from the fire whose fuel is men and stones. over which there are angels, malaika, shadidun. They're powerful and stern, right? And they do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what He tells them to do. They do exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them to do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them in this ayah, it's incumbent upon us to save ourselves from the fire. When you save yourself from the fire, then He says what? Then save your family from the fire, whose fuel has been a stone. What does that mean? It means that instead of making the fire stay burning with some wood, or put some oil or some rocks, Allah SWT said He's using people as the fuel. Oh, put some more in there, we need some more fuel, we need some more. And you're throwing people in there to fuel the fire. There's an ayat in the Quran, we got to fear the fire. There's an ayat in the Quran that Allah SWT said that on the day of judgment, or in one of the punishments of the people of the fire, is that Allah SWT will burn your skin, replace it, and burn it again, and then replace it. This is one of the punishments of the fire. In the Tafsir Ibn Kathir, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he explains that in one day, your skin burns, replenishes itself, burns and replenishes itself 10,000 times. In one day. 10,000 times. Your body is burned, put back, burned, put back, burned, and put back 10,000 times. So what's so significant about your body being burned and then replenished? The scientists tell us that when your skin is burned all the way, when there's no more nerves, you don't feel nothing. So in Allah's wisdom, He said, okay, I burned it off, I'm going to put it back on you. So you can feel it all over again. You can feel the whole pain all over. It's a never-ending pain. That's what some of us, now just think, 10,000 times your skin is burned all the way up and put back in. You can't even take 10,000 lashings. You can't even take 10,000 butt whoopings from a belt in one day. Let alone have your skin being taken off and burned in one day. Maybe you gotta feel the fire. If you don't fear the fire, if you don't understand the reality of the fire, you ain't gonna fear the fire. I'm gonna tell you what, I'm gonna give you a fire test. Who wants to see what it would be like to be in the hellfire? Don't nobody wanna see that, right? You don't wanna go to the hellfire. Don't nobody wanna feel the hellfire, right? I tell you what, I'll give you a test, the kids right here. A test. Go to the bathroom, turn on the shower as hot as you can, and just jump up in there and see what happens. Let's see how long you can stand up in that shower. Right? Not even a second, huh? Or somebody put the bath water, they did it too high, you try to sit up in the house. Ow! Man, you can't even sit in there for a hot second, can you? Right? That's just hot water. That ain't no hot fire. That's hot water. You understand? That's water. But Allah said, man, forever? Ever, ever like this? Ever? Not for a second, child. Oh, man, that hurts. You jump all around the house for that 1 second of hotness. For one hot second, you jump all around the house for that one hot second. Now, what about when Allah says that these angels, they are shadeed. They will hold you down. You can't move. So if you're getting burned or whatnot, or you're getting this fire, or your skin is being replenished, you have no get back. Because these angels, they only do what Allah SWT tells them to do. They only do what Allah SWT tells them to do. So when you understand this reality, of this fire, or you understand the reality of your skin being burned up, or you understand this reality of this threat from Allah SWT, then guess what, inshallah, you will move differently. You will move properly. Again, speaking about the Muslim identity. Muslim identity. We must be very proud of being Muslims. When you are proud of being a Muslim, right? It's okay to use the mixed swag. It's okay not to wear gold. It's okay. It's okay to wear your kufi, right? It's okay to say assalamu alaikum. It's okay to wear the kameez. It's okay. It's okay to wear the thobe, man. It's okay. It's all right, man. I like it. Matter of fact, the thobe, I feel like a prince. Okay? So we turn it into our own little thing. Islam is not about looking like a vagabond. Islam, man, you know, they were, the Sahabas, they were rich. They had money, they had falus, man. They had rings and watches and things like that, man. They were dapper dab, man. There was nothing scrub about them. Okay, they had money. Not only did they have money, but they also had power. They had wives. Okay? So the life of a Muslim is not a dull, it's not a dull life. The life of a Muslim is not a sucker life. We're not suckers, man. Actually, we're soldiers and we're men. Okay? We strive to do things on a whole other plane. Again, Muslim identity. Okay? When you walk down the street, they should know that's a Muslim. When you come up in a situation, or even if you're in school, right? The Muslim is the best at everything that he or she does. The Muslim is the best. You go to school, the Muslim should not have any write-ups in school. Muslim identity. The Muslim kid, go to school, you should not be the ones getting write-ups. You should not be the ones they calling their mom on the phone every day. They'll come get him, he acting up again. Not the Muslim. And if the Muslim's the one acting up, then guess what? Something wrong with that Muslim. Because the Muslim, we have the best of that. We have the best etiquettes. We have the best manners. Huh? We have the best discipline. Huh? We got the best attention span. Man, we listen and we pay attention. Right? Because we're the most intelligent. We're supposed to be. Right? Regardless of what they told us, or regardless of what we've been taught, or regardless of what we think, man, we're very intelligent. The Muslims are very intelligent. Don't let nobody tell you that you're not intelligent. They don't want you to be intelligent, but the Muslim is the most intelligent. If we teach the child from a young age, as the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when you raise a child in Islam, the Islam, it mixes with the child's blood. It becomes a part of that person. You teach that child how to make salat. You teach that Muslim child, that Muslim girl how to wear hijab or niqab at an early age. It becomes automatic with them. It's not something that they have to think about. Oh, I gotta put my kufi on. Oh, I gotta put the hijab on again. No, they see their mama wearing hijab. They see their mama wearing niqab. They see their daddy, you know what I'm saying, conducting himself like a Muslim. They see daddy, daddy ain't sagging. Daddy ain't cussing. Daddy making salat. Daddy dressing like a Muslim. Man, daddy handling his business. Man, daddy told me to make the adhan in the house because it's time for salat. So the akima salat is being established in the house. That's the way of a Muslim, man. We real men. Again, we're not suckers. The Muslim man is a real man. We establish Islam in the house. We establish Islamic order in the house. We make sure that all the kids is conducting themselves like Muslims. We make sure that all the girls conducting themselves like Muslims. We make sure that our daughters don't have boyfriends and girlfriends and all that other stuff. Because I'm going to say girlfriends too, because a lot of women out here, they're dyking right now. And they like it right now. But they're dyking right now. Okay? This new phenomenon. All women want to be with a woman. Even Muslim sisters. I don't see it. So ain't nothing I'm saying far-fetched. So we have to teach our children how to be Muslims. And it goes to the fathers and the mothers. Family structure, Muslim identity, okay? The children, you have to have a Muslim identity. The mother, she must have a Muslim identity. She must use this Muslim identity with her daughters. If you're not wearing hijab properly, don't expect your daughter to wear hijab properly. If you're not making salat, don't expect your daughter to make salat. If you're not being modest, if you're not being one who is, as a woman, she's not supposed to be seen, she's not supposed to be heard, right? You're supposed to teach the woman, as it says in the Hadith, how does the virgin, how do you know that she accepts a marriage? Because she's silent. She doesn't say anything. This is in the Hadith. So the women back in the time, Rasulullah SAW, you couldn't hear a woman. You couldn't hear her speak. And if she did speak, she was behind a hijab. What does it mean? It means that she was behind something. You couldn't look at her. And then it says that when you talk, she should talk with a firm voice. Don't make this voice sound all sexy. It should be firm to the point, no, it's not here, by her. Why? Because Allah SWT said there may be a disease in the heart of the man. Oh, well, I'm insecure. I'm secure about myself, and that's insecurity. We ain't saying nothing about your security, insecurity. We're saying when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that there may be a disease, a marada, some type of disease in the heart. So that person might hear that one little, assalamu alaikum, brother. And you open up that disease. But if she follows the tenets of Islam, be firm, be behind the hijab. You can't even see that woman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's al-Alim, He's al-Kareem, He's all Hakim, He's the all eye, so He knows better than us. He said, don't do this because it is. Don't do this because it is. Don't do this because it is. We said, oh, well, I think I know better. I can do better. And then we wonder why this happens. Because we didn't follow the rules. They say, stick to the game, stick to the script, and you won't go wrong. Okay? Same thing with this deen. You follow this deen, you can't go wrong. You follow these set rules. Right? And you'll be successful in this game of life. This is this game of life, this game of the deen of Islam, man. Follow these rules and you'll be successful. You follow any other blueprint, you follow any other rules, any other guidelines, commandments, or whatnot, you will not be successful. Again, Muslim identity. Man, we have to be, again, we have, I'm saying again, we have to be proud to be Muslims. You can't be afraid to be a Muslim. I don't want to tell nobody I'm a Muslim. I don't want to tell nobody my Muslim name. Well, what's your name? It's Muhammad, but you call me Mo. Well, what's your name? Well, it's Rahman, but you call me Randy. Or, I don't know. That's not Muslim identity. Huh? That's being scared of who you are. I'm not scared. I wasn't scared of being a non-Muslim. I'm not going to be scared of being a Muslim. That's for us that were born non-Muslims. See, when Allah blesses you with something, you appreciate it. We never had Islam, so when He gave it to us, we have to appreciate it because we could have been Sumun Bukun Umun, Fahun Da Yarji Umun. We could have been those who are deaf, dumb, and blind. We could have been those walking down the street, the walking dead. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I don't know what you're saying. I don't know what you're saying. I don't know what you're saying at all. Are you saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah? Muhammad Rasulullah? So, then I don't know what you're saying. Because that which leads to success in this life and the life to come is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Period. Don't let nobody lie to you, man. Don't let nobody think that Lil Wayne got it going on. He's going to the hellfire. I said it. Lil Wayne going to the hellfire. Jay-Z going to the hellfire. Beyonce going to the hellfire. Well, let me correct this. If they don't take shahada before they die, they're going to be in the hellfire. How about that one? Let me correct. I can't say who's going to the hellfire and who ain't going to the hellfire. If they don't take shahada, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with any other religion, any other deen other than Islam, what? You'll be at the khasirin. You'll be at the losers, man. So, Lil Wayne, hellfire. Jay-Z, hellfire. All these dudes y'all listen to on radio and whatnot, kafirs, and they're going to the hellfire. So guess what? If you love them, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you will be with those whom you love. If you know more Jay-Z than you know Quran, make that look to yourself. You know more Lil Wayne than Hadith, you better look to yourself. You can't recite Fatiha properly, but I can say one verse or one line of Jay-Z, you can start from right there and go and finish the whole song, you got a problem. But I can recite Kafi Noon and you can't finish, you got a problem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in one of the hadith Qudsi, He said, do not curse the time. Don't curse time because Allah is the time. And He'll ask you on the day of judgment as to what you did with your time. What did you do with your time? I listened to music. I played video games all day, so my mind became mush. So now I live in fantasy land. Because you were the champion on the video game, you think you're the champion in real life. You haven't even fought nobody yet. But you're good at Call of Duty. You're good at Call of Duty, you can kill people enough, but can you do a push-up? Have you trained? No. Okay. So let's stop living in fantasy land and start doing things in reality. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us to go learn how to shoot. He said, go learn how to shoot. He said, like your brother Ismail alayhi salam. Y'all know about Ismail? Y'all know about Ismail alayhi salam? You know who he was? Yes? No? It's okay, sir. Ismail alayhi salam was the firstborn son of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Abraham. Not only that, his mother was Hajar. So again, Abraham, you know about Abraham, right? Ibrahim? Abraham? right? He had two wives. First wife was Sarah, the second wife was Hagar. Okay? She was black. Did you know that? Did you know that? Did you know Abraham had a black wife? He had a black wife. Her name was Hagar. She was from Egypt, Cushite, and their son's name was Ishmael. Did you know that? You know? Okay. Well, now you know. Ishmael alayhi salam, who was the firstborn son of Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was black. He was African. So now you know. Don't forget that. Okay? Not only that Ishmael alayhi salam, who was from an African mother, not only that, did you know that he helped build the Kaaba? Did you know that Ishmael alayhi salam, this black son, that he helped Ibrahim alayhi salam build the Kaaba? Did y'all know that? Little man. This one, yeah. Did you know that? So Abraham and his black son, Ishmael alayhi salam, they built the foundations of the Kaaba. And through the lineage of Ishmael alayhi salam, through the lineage of Hagar, who was black, y'all listening? Talk to y'all right now, man. Hagar, who was black, who was the second wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam, through that lineage came the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Okay? Did you know that? Well, now you know. Let me say it again. Through the lineage of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and his son, through his second wife, Hagar, who was Cushite, or we say Hamites, black. They had a son whose name was Ishmael alayhi salam. Ishmael means God heard. God heard the prayer. What prayer? Ibrahim alayhi salam, he wanted to have a seed. He couldn't have a seed through the first wife, who was Sarah. But his blessed seed was through his second wife, Hagar, and he had Ishmael alayhi salam. Ishmael alayhi salam, not only did he help build the Kaaba with his father Ibrahim alayhi salam, but when they built the Kaaba, they also made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and his son Ishmael alayhi salam, for Allah to bless the city of Mecca and to bless that city with a prophet to come from their lineage. From what lineage? Through Ishmael. And the prophet that came was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? You have to know your Islamic identity, man. Know who you are. Know what you came from. Know what it is that you're following. Right? So now you understand. So now you understand. Little, what should that mean? What should that mean? So little man, so now you know that Abraham had two wives, huh? And one of them was black. I want you to forget that, right? One of Abraham's wives was black. Her name was Hagar. They had a son, and that son's name was Ishmael. So Ishmael was a prophet, yeah. Ishmael was a prophet. And he was black. Okay? I want you to forget that. Did everybody say that? I told you that. And it's real. It's not hocus pocus. I'm not just saying it because I'm black. This is from Quran. This is from Hadith. This is a reality. Okay? But if you don't know these things, then, you know, it won't help you with your psyche. You understand what I'm saying? So now you know that somebody that looks just like you was a prophet. You know that somebody that looks just like you, she was a mother or a wife of a prophet. You understand what I'm saying? That's kind of cool, ain't it? Huh? Yeah. Okay. So, Muslim identity. You know, we must understand that as Muslims, we should be proud to be Muslims. We should be happy to be Muslims. We should not be shy to be Muslims. Okay? We should walk with confidence. Because guess what? By us being Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saving us from the hellfire. Because we say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, one day, inshallah, not at all, but if we do have to go to the hellfire, because the Muslims, there's some Muslims that will go to the hellfire. Not everybody's born straight to heaven. We're not Christians. This ain't Christianity. We believe everybody's born to heaven. This is not Christianity. In Islam, it's amal, it's works, good deeds, bad deeds, heaven, hell, punishment, reward. Very simple. You do this, this is what's going to happen. You do this, this is what's going to happen. Unless he wishes to forgive you. Okay? So we don't want to be just Muslims. We want to be mu'minis. We want to be mu'minin or mu'minat. Right? We want to be those who are saved from the fire. Inshallah. Okay? So again, Muslim identity. I'm going to go ahead and cut and shut this down because we're going to eat a little bit before Isha. And Isha's at 7, so it gives about 30 minutes to eat, inshallah. But again, today, just a nasiha, man, just a reminder. You know, just a reminder, a little bit, give you a little bit of knowledge or understanding of your deen and your religion. So you have a better understanding of what it is that you believe in, what it is that you are in. You in a cold religion, man. We in a cold religion. We don't even understand how deep it is. And we're parts of it. And we can be major parts of it if we believe it, though. You got to believe that you are somebody. If you don't believe that you ain't somebody, you ain't going to be nobody. I believe I'm somebody. Just by saying, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I am somebody. Not only that, Allah SWT tells me in Surah Al-Hujurat, chapter 49, He said, Allah SWT created all different tribes and different nations so that you can know one another. But the best of you, the son of Allah, is the one who has the most taqwa. So it ain't got nothing to do with me, my color. It ain't got nothing to do with how much money I got in my pocket. It ain't got nothing to do with how tall or short or fat or slim or swole or whatnot. It ain't got nothing to do with that. All I have to do is work on my taqwa, and I can be the best in the son of Allah. Well, let me go ahead and work on that taqwa. You could be a prince in the son of Allah. You could be the best in the son of Allah with no money in your pocket. You understand? Because Allah don't look at your money. When you die, you take your money with you? Can't take what you take, your good deeds. Okay? Well, I'm going to shut it down right now, inshallah. And if y'all want to talk afterwards that we eat right now, inshallah, we can talk. But I'm going to shut it down, just give you a little dhikr, a little reminder, something to think about. You know, this deen is, you know, this deen is the best thing going. Don't let nobody tell you something different. As a Muslim, man, this is the best thing going. Maybe because we don't see, you know, strong Muslim men, and you know what I'm saying? You need to see that. You need to see Muslim men that got it going on, man. You need to see, man, we dress well as well. Ain't nothing wrong with us in how we dress, man. We don't walk around here looking good, you know what I'm saying, like we got a sauerkraut around our lips, you know what I'm saying, we're crusty or nothing like that. Man, the Muslim man, we're the best, man. We're the best hygienic, we're the best smelling, okay? We're the best dressed, okay? But you got to believe it and receive it, you understand? And so I'm going to close out. Any questions? No? We'll close out, inshallah. We got pizza, you know, we got pizza and water, so inshallah, say bismillah when we eat. And inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with this coming together. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whenever we come together in dhikr Allah, the angels, they formulate, and inshallah, they ask for forgiveness of us. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us of some of our sins today, or some of our sayyat, inshallah, for attending this ta'aleem and trying to dhikr Allah, inshallah. Ameen. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر